गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन, आई एम रवि गुप्ता, आई एम सीईओ एंड फाउंडर ऑफ इलेट्स टेक्नो मीडिया प्राइवेट लिमिटेड। वी आर ए 17 ईयर ओल्ड ऑर्गेनाइजेशन हु हैव बीन वर्किंग इन द आइडियाज ऑफ गवर्नेंस, एजुकेशन, हेल्थ, बैंकिंग एंड फाइनेंस एंड सेवरल अदर सेक्टर्स, एंड वी आर डॉक्यूमेंटिंग एंड डिसमिनेटिंग व्हाट आर द इनोवेशंस व्हिच आर हैपनिंग इन दीस sectors. So we are overall working in more than 30 sectors. Today we are honored to have with us Valsa Nair Singh. She is an IAS officer. She is the principal secretary and inquiry officer, GAD, civil aviation and excise and tourism and cultural affairs. And this talk is very important in the context that because of the COVID-19 situation, there is a lot of impact on the tourism sector, excise sector, aviation sector, and we are going to discuss with her on how is COVID-19 going to change or impact these industries. So welcome, Valsa ji. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
And before we start a discussion with her, may I request her to please talk about her education, her career in the IAS, how has been her journey in the government, what all departments and responsibilities she has undertaken till now. Valsa ji, please.
Thank you, Dr. Gupta, and good morning to all of you. It's an honor to be a part of this ELETS webinar group. Though I wish it was in better times and not in the kind of times which we are passing through. Though I'm hopeful we are going to come out of this, which as we always have in any crisis. Talking about my career, I joined the IAS in 1991. Prior to that, I did my BA in English Literature from Cochin, and I followed up with a Master's in History. And I also have a postgraduate diploma in journalism and public relations as well. And once I got into the IAS, I was in the Uttar Pradesh cadre. I began my career in Ghaziabad district as SDM of Dadri, a small subdivision of the headquarters division. And followed that, I was working with the Noida Authority and the Greater Noida Authority for a substantial time. I was looking after the institution allotment and many exciting opportunities, because those two were really emerging as big satellite towns of Delhi. And it's an experience which I found as very, very beneficial to me in my later career. I took a cadre change to Maharashtra subsequently. And in Maharashtra, I started my career as a Chief Executive Officer, Jilla Parishad in Chandrapur district. And followed up with the same position in Gadchiroli district. So these were heavily Naxalite infested districts at that time. And working as a CEO, which is at the, you know, the cutting edge of the development agenda of the government, was an extremely challenging experience. So, because as a CEO, you look at the 12 major departments, development departments of the government, and it was like, you know, it's what you read about, what you talk about. This is an experience when you actually live those things. So following that, I got posted to Mumbai, and I done a variety of postings in Mumbai from Department of Planning. I was collector of Mumbai City, and I was divisional commissioner also of Konkan Division, followed up with Environment Department for 5 years. Then I went abroad for a master's degree in Syracuse University. Then back, tourism, excise, aviation, and doing the in this portfolio for quite some time.
Fantastic. Great range of experience you have in the IAS journey from various departments, and also you have worked in UP and also right now working in Maharashtra. Now we let's discuss about the COVID-19 situation and how it is going to impact the tourism sector. Your assessment and your views on this subject, please.
I think COVID has been the most devastating experience for tourism. It has been for the whole world. But if you have to pick a sector, I would say that tourism is, it's the death knell of tourism, because when there is no travel, that's the backbone of tourism. You know, travel by any means. If you cannot get from place A to place B, there is no tourism traveler after that. It's the absolute devastation for the industry. And we are expecting the, of course, international tourism is not going to happen in India, as I see, for another 2 years. But domestic tourism, I think, will slowly pick up. And with the kind of fear psychosis which people have, and I would not foresee anything happening in this sector for about till September, October. With social distancing, we will start with baby steps. I would like to say, why is tourism so important to economy? Why are we so worried about, you know, why COVID affects tourism? You know, it's a sector which has brought in about $240 billion of foreign exchange to India. It has a contribution of 9.2% to our GDP and almost 8.1% of the total expenditure. We have almost 6 crore of people employed in India in the tourism sector. Because of COVID, about 2 to 3 crores of people are going to be laid off. It was the backbone of the employment sector in industry. It was tourism is a sector which is very well suited for an economy like India. It's a very low capital intensive industry. It has highly labor intensive sector, and the economic multiplier effect in tourism was so big. One tourist comes and spends. It is not just the hotel who makes money. You know, a range of activities are related to that one particular tourist arrival. So the multiplier effect was so big. So with all this aspect, the contribution of tourism to the Indian economy was so big. So any small crisis with the tourism industry goes through has a much larger impact on the Indian economy. It's not only direct employment, a very large sector of indirect employment is also linked to tourism and also induced employment. I will always say that this is like the most equitable distribution of employment. You have from the highly experienced general manager of a hotel, the vast experienced hotel, to the totally unskilled gardener in the resort, or the telephone operator, or the housekeeping. So the range of employment this sector provides is enormous. So this kind of a vast spectrum, along with the low capital investment, was the most ideal sector for India with its massive tourism sites and destinations. It was the way forward for us, and we were doing pretty well. But I am very hopeful that despite this also, with the kind of strategies which the government, both the ministry and the state governments, are making, we will bounce back in about 3 to 4 months. Many state governments across the world have done that. If you look at Sri Lanka after the terrorism attack of 2018, it took Sri Lanka just 6 to 8 months to come back. Of course, this pandemic is global and it has a wider reach. So we may take a little longer time, but you have seen the tourism is always the first to get affected in such a scenario, and always the first to bounce back also. Kerala after the floods 2 years ago have come back. So we are working on that direction.
Fantastic. You are also in charge of the aviation department. So civil aviation also is a big employer of people. So how are you seeing the impact on the aviation sector?
In the aviation, the most of the regulatory and the policy powers are within the jurisdiction of the Ministry of Civil Aviation. In the state government, what we stress us is on mostly on regional connectivity and also the ATF related, GST related part of the ATF. So in regional connectivity, we'll pick up much after the domestic airlines and international airlines pick up. Maharashtra was one of the leading states of rural connectivity, which is the Udaan scheme. You know, we had about 22 flights in Udaan going on, and we had TrueJet and SpiceJet and Indigo, all are part of our Udaan network. And we had connected almost 10 underserved and unserved airports to Mumbai in that. So that was helping the economic development of those districts in Maharashtra. Better investment was coming in, like Solapur and Nanded, Kolhapur, Nashik. They were all connected part of the RCS. So I think once the domestic airlines pick up and the aviation sector comes back, then RCS will of course follow suit. But sadly, aviation is a sector which is as badly hit as the tourism sector is. See, once when you talk about social distancing, we are thinking about a scenario in which you would not have flights with a middle seat in. How do you do a social distancing? In fact, I read an article yesterday which says that in a single row, only one passenger could sit. That would make airlines, it's totally unviable for airlines to fly. And then what? Slowly they start winding up. In fact, Virgin Australia has just wound up about a week ago. So we are looking at a pretty bleak future for aviation, and it looks like massive government support would be needed at policy level and also the fiscal incentives. And I'm sure it will be a part of the government agenda.
You all are also in charge of the excise department, and excise is also hit in this lockdown situation. And it is like hitting the revenue of the state also. So how do you see the situation in excise department?
In fact, all the three departments I am in are the ones which have, bearing the brunt of corona, I must say. Yeah. So, excise is one of the biggest revenue earners of any state, including Maharashtra. In Maharashtra, it is the third biggest after GST and stamp duty, and followed by auto registration. So, we bring in about 28,000 to 30,000 crores to the Maharashtra treasury every year. Now, because of this, all restaurants, all hotels have been shut, all bars, all wine shops, everything has been shut for more than a month, and it's cost us almost 1500 to 1600 crores a month just by shutting it. But with social distancing, whether it can be open, but as per the MHA notification, liquor shops have to be closed, and they continue to remain closed till the time there would be a relaxation. The states are all looking at a very bleak future when it talks about finance. I mean, it's many states have already taken up the issue with the center also. This is a bad time for excise, but the last notification allows the liquor manufacturing units to begin operation. So accordingly, those units have just started about last Monday onwards as part of the new relaxation. So I think some amount of money would come into the kitty. People who have made massive investments and set up restaurants on the highways and then on the resorts, and it would be, a crisis for each one of them.
You had mentioned about the tourism sector impact and its possible revival in 3, 4, or 5, 6 months. So how, you discussed about Kerala situation, that how did Kerala revive the tourism market? You mentioned about Sri Lanka, how it revived after their challenges. So how do you see in your state, what are the steps government can take to revive the tourism industry?
In tourism in Maharashtra or in any state in India, I think the way forward would be to focus on domestic tourism. So we are a country of 5.4 billion people. In times like this, that is one of our biggest assets. We have just our own people to fall back on, and they are enough. They can sustain the business in this country. So we are not dependent on international tourism. We have no option. And I see that we need to just focus on domestic tourism. We need to sort of rekindle the interest in our people of discovering our own country. It's like Bharat Ek Khoj 2.0. Let us contribute not only to the tourism of the state, but to Indian economy by traveling within the country as and when the lockdown is eased out. So in Maharashtra, we hope to start a campaign on Discover Maharashtra. So the brand and all would be worked out in due course of time. So this would be like, how well do you know your state? So we would run a campaign among school, college children, among the traveling part, the 20 to 40 age of youth who always like to have the experience in tourism and who are heavily into adventure tourism. So that would be step one of that. Step two, I think, is we need to create a database of all the tourism stakeholders in the state. during this crisis, as we were trying to grapple with, we realized that we really do not have a database. It could be hoteliers, it could be tour operators, travel agents, tourism cab owners, souvenir shop, retail shop. People are all in the business. So we really did not have guides. So our step two would be to create a database. So even if there is a repeat of any such incident later on, we are well equipped to handle it from day one. You know? So this would be lockdown time is a homework for us to ensure to create a defense against future such threats. And we also will be focusing on skilling, and especially digital skilling, because it's only social media which is now stood up against all this. So we need to talk about media promotion through social media and how to have more of digitally skilled people in the tourism sector. So state government would work in close coordination with the Ministry of Tourism to ensure that we have more and more skilled people in this sector now. Best use of technology for this tourism sector. This, if anything which this pandemic has taught us, it is shifting to the use of new technology and making the best of this technology for us. So one way which I would look at is using of technology is creation of virtual tours. If you can't come to Ajanta Ellora, why not let Ajanta Ellora come into your drawing room? You know, you sit in your house, you click and do a virtual tour of the place. And when you do that, not only are you getting experience of being a tourist, but somewhere in your mind, you make a comment, someday I have to visit it. So you mark it as a must-visit destination for a year later, 2 years later. So you will try and do more of virtual tours of Ajanta Ellora, of the Tadoba Tiger Trails, Pinch Tiger Reserve, you know, Nashik, Mumbai, you know, all the destinations which we talk about. So virtual tour is something we talk about. Another bigger advantage which Mumbai has, it is the home of the event industry. You know, all the major events happen. About 50% of the major events happen in Mumbai. So the event industry is about 4,000 to 5,000 crore in Mumbai. So I think that we will use event, or rather MICE, meetings, in incentives, conference and exhibition, as one of the launch pads for reviving tourism. So state government will facilitate and bring in curated events to Mumbai and all over the state. And this not only gets visitors, it takes occupancy high, it creates a whole ecosystem around it, goes up. So these are some of the steps we have worked out. And in the policy level, we think that this is the most apt time to implement ease of doing business in business. So this is also the time to bring in investment into the state, because we would be looking at further incentivizing capital investment into Maharashtra now, and ensuring there is a single window, absolute simplification of processes for all the potential investors and also event organizers or any other stakeholder in the tourism business. These are some of the strategy which we have already worked out.
Fantastic. It looks interesting that the department is already thinking about wage and steps to be taken for revival of the industry. There is a one of the issues which we have read, that the travel associations and the hotels all are demanding and for relaxation on GST, the taxes, and many are even asking for waive-offs on taxes for 6 months. So, although the central government is already in a financial deficit due to the corona situation, so how feasible do the thing like this catch 22 situation?
Yes, I agree with you. The center is also looking at, you know, financial resources not very good, but the central government is in the process of working out a stimulus package. And in the MSME sector, many of the tourism organization would fit into that criteria. So I think the waiver of GST, the moratorium on the loan repayment, and the TDS and TCS demand by the tourism stakeholders have all been made to the Ministry of Tourism, and Ministry of Tourism has further represented to the Ministry of Finance. So though they are not in the jurisdiction of the state government, the states are all supporting their demand, because ultimately it's economy if you cannot grow on your own. It's all the Maharashtra's economy will grow only if all the neighboring states and if India's economy pick up. So all the states would be happy to support it, and I'm sure state government under the central government would take a very judicious view of the representations, keeping in mind the resources they have and also their future plan. The state government would not be in a position to do more of fiscal incentives, but I am told that one state has looked at reimbursement of the GST. So we are just studying that, and we will explore if the finances of Maharashtra do permit that. Apart from that, state government will look at more of non-fiscal incentives. One of the interesting demands made by an agency has been to introduce some kind of a employment guarantee scheme, like the MNREGA, which is there in the other sector. Why not have a EGS for tourism sector? So it's a very interesting concept which the Ministry of Tourism has been represented this. And another scheme which I thought was like, you know, you have different schemes for different sectors. And tourism, though it does not have the definition of an industry, I think it's high time we had some kind of a Paryatan Protsahan Yojana, in which the more number of tourists visit a destination, the more you incentivize the people who bring in the tours, the hotels there. So it's very nascent stage, and we have time to work out. So this is just a thought which came to me.
Yes, yes. And the aggressive marketing like we have had, which are known in the tourism sector, especially done by Kerala, or the Incredible India concepts, which are highly aggressive marketing. So do you think that marketing has to happen now internally in India itself for increasing the domestic tourism? Your suggestion?
In fact, I think that's the only way out. Very, very aggressive domestic marketing. And I think every state would be working on such thing. Kerala's success and Rajasthan is very much on their aggressive marketing. Kerala has taken Ayurveda to the whole world. Yes. So, you know, it's a USP of Kerala. So similarly, Rajasthan with its majestic forts and palaces have really made that into a must visit destination for anybody's calendar. So every state will and must go in for a very big domestic campaign. And I think, you know, 2 years of very hardcore domestic marketing, increasing your footfalls to your state, and later on moving into an international situation. Because I think till the time there is a vaccine, we should not think about international arrivals with flights and quarantine, and nobody really would want to come. So this aggressive marketing, and it has to be a sustained campaign for about a year. I think 2021 is where when we'll get back to the kind of arrivals which we had prior to COVID. This whole 6-7 months, we'll just be picking up, and we are already working on different campaign ideas.
You mentioned about the MICE industry. If you look at Dubai or Singapore or Hong Kong, Malaysia, Thailand, all have aggressively worked on the MICE industry promotion, and they are like events hub of the world, and they have tried to attract the big and the small event organizers both to their cities, and given ease of doing business opportunities, so that event organizing is with less hassle, less police approvals and other approvals which are cumbersome in India. So do you think a specific focus, marketing focus on MICE is also required?
In fact, it's quite surprisingly that about a month before the corona broke out, the Honorable Minister of Tourism had chaired a meeting only on MICE. And we have almost completed drafting a new event policy also. So
okay.
Now after the lockdown is over, an appropriate time we'll bring it. So this talks about only on simplification of approvals for events and all the MICE events coming into Maharashtra. and how to ensure that we get more and more events into here. I mean, we had started work much before this COVID. So this COVID is only probably been a catalyst now for us to bring it out soon. So that spoke about simplification of licenses, online approvals, and also bringing down to the minimum number of licenses and how the Department of Tourism would play the role of a facilitator to every event organizer coming into the state. Because MICE brings in enormous amount of economy revenue to the city. As we have found, we have major events, music concerts and all have come into Maharashtra. You know, we had Justin Bieber and we had Coldplay and big singers have come in, and that their number of people who flew into the city just watch that has been enormous. So we want to grab this opportunity and make everybody get up and realize that yes, this is the destination for any event. So in about 3 months we will have this new event policy on the go.
And you also mentioned about creating virtual tours of important monuments. There is another strategy which I have seen in Europe and some of the American tourist sites, like that each destination having a its own marketing campaign, like Paris or London or Holland. So Nasik having its own huge end-to-end marketing campaign, online websites, Facebook ads, LinkedIn ads, and everything happening. And even the monuments having a like Eiffel Tower has a Twitter handle. So each destination having a Twitter handle, Facebook handle, and it is like talking daily about some of the activities which are happening. So it's a like a huge digital tourism activity. And also some of the European sites have like if you go there, like they have a sound guide. Like if you install it here, and they will tell you that this is the history of like this place, this pillar has this history, all that stuff is like a visual, audio visual guide which is provided in many of the tourist destination in Europe and USA. So do you think that an effort in that direction is needed in Maharashtra?
Monument wise websites, I don't think will happen for some time because of the kind of numbers that we haven't reached. The Eiffel Tower itself, in fact, the Louvre had 60 million people visiting it, and so that's the kind of numbers they're talking about. One city itself gets more than tourists of any country, you know. So that's the kind of numbers there. So here, but there are many districts in Maharashtra who already have their own tourism websites, and also the district websites has a very large portion dedicated to the tourism sites and tourism, how to provide. How? What are the sites to see and destinations see and whom to contact and all those things are there. We are not looking at independent monument websites for the moment. But talking about audio guides, many monuments in Maharashtra already have that. Like if you go to one of our famous UNESCO sites like Ajanta Ellora or Elephant Islands, we have the audio guides right to it. But we need to probably get the audio guides in different languages also now to ensure that, you know, there is a comfort factor for every tourist visiting it. One thing Maharashtra Tourism is would do in the next 3 months is to really, really ramp up our websites. Because now with COVID, it is the only face to the world. You know, people are not going to able to visit your site. So we are going to really, really ramp it up and take our website into one of, you know, absolutely interactive one. We're sitting in your house. We are going to enable you to travel through Maharashtra, to trek into Sahyadris, or go river rafting in the Kolad River, or be a part of the Varkari Yatra. You know, we are going to make every people who come to each person to website a part of the Maharashtra's ethos.
Fantastic. And the one of the important USP which Maharashtra has is the rural tourism. Yeah, like you have rural areas which are serene and which are very nice, but they're under marketed. So do you think that a specific focus on the rural tourism will be of interest?
Definitely, yes. It's a very nice, good question. In fact, rural tourism is a very, very big factor here. And we are just floating a new agro-tourism policy. The draft note has been made and it's just been circulated to other concerned departments for their comments. So that will, of course, we will have a dedicated link in our main website where you can, with a click, you know about all the agro-tourism possibilities. So they are more, in fact, there are quite a few of them doing very well now. We have students from US and UK coming in and spending a long time in our agro-tourism facilities where they do farming on their own. They do the harvesting along with the farmers. They come and have dinner with them and cultural shows in the night. So these are there. Now what we need to take them is to probably create a portal and take them to more and more people who are want to know about it. And secondly, we need to trip it capacity building of the people who run these. You know, unless we have standards of hygiene and safety, it would not give a comfort to anybody to come and stay there. Now, especially with post-COVID, we are going to come out with very strict guidelines on hygiene and sanitation. You would go to a place A only if you know it fulfills all these criteria of safety. So that guidelines should be drafted and circulated to all. And when you go to a resort, any facility or agro facility, you're going to check up look at the checklist. Is the yes tick in all the boxes? Only then would you want to go in. So we need to do capacity building in all these farmers, all the farmers, the operators, the actual people who work, the housekeeping staff. And we need to ensure that the service offered is contactless. In these times of COVID, that is, I would say, something which we need to stress upon. So all these policies, we need to rework again and to ensure that this remains one of the most important criteria.
And there is another aspect about education tourism. If you look at the last 3-4 years, schools and higher education, there were like tour operators taking school kids to Paris, school kids to London, and naming it education tourism, that we are going to show you the heritage of Rome, heritage of Holland, heritage of London. And it was called education tourism. And I am like sitting in NCR and I see that almost half of the schools, even the so rich schools, were like lapping it. And same if we, in my kids' school, in fact, they took him the class to Amritsar by train to show the Golden Temple. So that as a concept, even for school and same for higher education, like your Pune is the higher education hub for the country. And so many, like earlier, the international students have arrived. Now this may dip this year. But our own students are actually not aware about the heritage of India. So are you thinking about any efforts for school and higher education tourism in the state itself, which may help?
Definitely on the thinking on the same lines. In fact, we have already actually had internal brainstorming on this about a couple of days ago, on which how we make the schools and the colleges travel to destinations within the state. Anyway, now the question of going abroad doesn't come for the 2 years. So we would want, like I said, know your own state, you know, discover Maharashtra. Let it begin with the schools. So Maharashtra, luckily, we have such big 7 UNESCO heritage sites. We have the beautiful Sahyadris for trekking. So if school groups for adventure, the trekking would be the ideal place. Then we have the beaches, Sindhudurga and Ratnagiri beaches. So there is the kind of canvas is Maharashtra boasts. Really, really good. And not only Maharashtra, any state in India. Once you look at it, there is so much within you. One thing if COVID taught us, when you can't go outside, go inside. So this is the time for us to, you know, start exploring your place and weekend destinations from Mumbai. So I think this crisis will lead us all into exploring our state, not only the schools and colleges. So for them, we can make it mandatory that you do educational tour only within India or within your state. but even for every other entrepreneur who loves traveling to get the work stress off, India has so much to offer. That's a lesson which COVID-19 has taught each of us.
So, madam, there are some questions here on your screen on the Q&A. If you can open it, please. There's a question. Just let me read it. Question by from Jaipur. It is talking about Maharashtra is highly impacted by the COVID-19 pandemic. How will it impact tourism in the state, and how do you think the damage could be minimized with perfect planning?
Yes. I think that I've already covered that in our strategy and the way forward. So that would be the plans which we hope to put in place.
Another question from Delhi, that it is said that every challenge is an opportunity. Do you think that the biggest learning for India's tourism sector will be focusing more on health, wellness and hygiene while rendering services as the new way of life?
I think, you know, COVID has made each of one of us think differently. It has made us, all of us, change our way of life. You know, the world is not the same anymore. It will never be the same anymore. So we all have taken a lot of lessons from this. And for tourism, this is a big lesson. I would not say one of the biggest, but this is a very big lesson which the tourism sector will carry forward.
There is a question from Uttarakhand. The question is that Maharashtra has got some amazing tourism attractions, particularly in the Western Ghats. Somehow it has not been able to market them as successfully as Kerala or MP. Any plans for course correction?
Yes, definitely there is. We have plans, like I was talking about, aggressive domestic marketing campaign. One aspect would be on the Western Ghats. In fact, like I was telling, camping sites in the Sahyadri, the trekking opportunity in the Sahyadri, also the beautiful majestic forts of the Maratha forts in the Sahyadris. These are all things which we would be a part of our new campaign. And I would also welcome you to come and experience the trekking in the Sahyadris as soon as they are open.
Great. There is a question from Varanasi that what role tourism sector will play in reviving economy post COVID-19? What will be your short-term and long-term measures?
I think I had already covered that, but just to reiterate that tourism is plays a very, very major role in the economy, especially for a country like India, as I said, because it's a low capital intensive and large number of employment opportunities. Also, it would be, I say, because of the cultural diversity of India, I think there's no other sector can bring it out like tourism does. So for all these facts, it's the backbone of Indian economy, and the government is really dedicated to ensure that the tourism sector bounces back in as shortest time as possible.
Great. I think with this, we can close the Q&A session. And before we end this, I would like to inform all the audience and our speaker that ILETS is trying to reach out to as many as departments across the country, government officials, and also the industry, schools, hospitals, everyone, to discuss about the possible changes needed in the COVID-19 situation. I would request Varsaji, your inputs on our efforts in these times of crisis, on our efforts of spreading ideas and doing discussions through online platform in these times of crisis.
No, so, I think you're doing a wonderful job, because, you know, people would like to know from the person actually who's doing it on what this situation is. It makes a big difference. Like where you had a lot of district magistrates, people in the urban bodies, collectors talking about what they're doing. So it gives the a lot of confidence in the viewer, what exactly is happening, because otherwise you really don't know. You get so many biased views. You don't know the real situation on the ground. When actually the person in the grassroots, cutting edge, talking about it, it gives you a lot of confidence. It gives you, that makes you know what is the reality. And it's a great opportunity of connecting also. I am really happy to be part of this. I have been following the ILETS talks for some time and never been able to be a participant. But I have followed the talks and I have enjoyed it. And I think I have learned a lot. And I really want to congratulate ILETS for taking me to the, you know, the virtual interview sort of. The best use of technology.
Thank you, Palsaji. We are encouraged by your words. And I will request all the audience, if you have liked this video, please like and share it on the Facebook and YouTube. This video is available on the ILETS handles on Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, and all other platforms. So with this, thank you, everyone. Thank you, Palsaji, for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.